Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. So when he heard that he was ill, he remained only 2 days in the place where he was. Then after this, he said to his disciples, "Let's go back to Judea." When Jesus arrived, he found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb for 4 days. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went to meet him, but Mary sat at home. Martha said to Jesus, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But even now I know that whatever you ask of God, God will give you." Jesus said to her, "Your brother will rise." Martha said, "I know he will rise in the resurrection on the last day." Jesus told her, "I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me, even if he dies, will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this?" She said to him, "Yes, Lord. I have come to believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God, the one who is coming into the world." He became perturbed and deeply troubled and said, "Where have you laid him?" They said to him, "Sir, come and see." And Jesus wept. So the Jews said, "See how he loved him." But some of them said, "Could not the one who spoke in the eyes of the blind man have done something so that this man would have not died?" So Jesus returned again, came to the tomb. It was a cave, and a stone laid across it. Jesus said, "Take away the stone." Martha, the dead man's sister, said to him, "Lord, by now there will be a stench. He has been dead for 4 days." Jesus said to her, "Did I not tell you that if you believe, you will see the glory of God?" So they took away the stone. And Jesus raised his eyes and said, "Father, I thank you for hearing me. I know that you always hear me. But because of the crowd here, I have said this, that they may believe that you sent me." And when he had said this, he cried out in a loud voice, "Lazarus, come out!" The dead man came out, tied hand and foot with burial cloths, and his face was wrapped in a cloth. So Jesus said to them, "Untie him and let him go." Now many of the Jews who had come to Mary and seen what he had done began to believe in him. The Gospel of the Lord. so grateful for the sacrifice of so many parishioners, parishioners who gave so generously their time, talent, and treasure to carry on the life of the church, to carry on the ministries here, in particular, who contributed all three to the building of this church. Most especially, we recall with gratitude Monsignor Flanagan for him and his vision in building this church to stand as a monument to the Second Vatican Council's vision for the church's response, how the church was to respond to the contemporary age for the evangelization of the world. Indeed, it stands as a great monument. It's a great monument, though, not only because of his vision, yes, beginning with that vision, but also a monument to all the sacrifice, determination, and hard work of so many parishioners. And really, determination, even at the point I understand, is moving the rectory, physically moving the rectory across the street to accommodate the building of this church. That's determination and no doubt in action. Why all this great sacrifice, generosity, hard work? It all comes down to the church's mission, the proclamation of the good news. The good news that we will be celebrating in 2 weeks, and what the readings this Sunday and all of these Sundays in Lent are preparing us for, especially these 3 Sundays in the middle of the season of Lent. Next Sunday, in Passion Sunday, Paul Sunday, and beginning of Holy Week. These 3 Sundays leading up to it, the reading, gospel readings, have been reflecting various themes of baptism as the church is getting us ready for the joyful
bishop, of Archbishop here. I'm privileged to meet many wonderful people all throughout our parishes in Eastern Counties, that is the Archdiocese of San Francisco, here in Marin and San Mateo. I meet many wonderful people in our parishes and different organizations and movements, groups in the Archdiocese that are doing many wonderful things. We don't hear about all of it, but there's a lot of good happening. But it has to be together in this spirit of communion if we're going to effectively carry out the mission of making disciples of all nations. It's also not just abstract theology. It's the heart of who we are. It is the theological principle. But theology isn't just to be left on the pages of a theology book. Theology defines who we are as we put it in action. And this sense of community, this theology of community, is also very practical. It's the way the church carries out anything that the church does. I like to refer to communion as the basic operating principle of the church. So, to give an example, we have the offices of the Archdiocese, which are there to support the parishes and their ministries, because that's the bottom line. That's where our people, the vast majority of our people, learn about Jesus Christ, grow in their love of Jesus Christ in their parishes, where they're taught the truths of the faith, where they receive the saving grace and sacraments, where they worship with their fellow believers, where they serve with their fellow Christians, their parish and the wider community. But the parishes don't have all the resources they need to sustain their ministries. For many things, they depend on the Archdiocese. Formation programs is one good example, and we can begin with the formation of priests. We're blessed to have a seminary in our Archdiocese, St. Patrick's Seminary in Menlo Park. Blessed to have one of our seminarians, who has my MC today, Patrick Summerhays. We have many wonderful seminarians. Obviously, a parish can't build and operate its own seminary. So it relies on the Archdiocese to form the priests so that you can have priests in your parishes, serene as your pastors. Father Arlington and Father Potter's London examples of our priestly formation at our seminary. There are many other practical things, too, that the parishes rely on the Archdiocese for help in managing their personnel, when legal issues arise, issues dealing with finances, and many other things that could go on and on. So the diocese is there, the Archdiocese, the offices are there to sustain the ministries of the parishes so that our people can be formed in the faith and become true disciples. But the Archdiocese also relies on the support of the parishes so that we can have the resources we need in order to provide these support services to our parishes. So you see, it really is a spirit of community. Community in this practical sense of collaboration, all of us contributing, all of us having a role in the mission of the church. Again, this time of Thanksgiving over these last 50 years and even beyond in the life of the Lawton Parish is a time of great gratitude, but also a time of hope. As I said, I'm happy to see the spirituality of stewardship, working together in the sense of community in your parish continues here. It's time to look forward with hope and renewed energy to continue the work of evangelization. Let us do so in the spirit of communion. We are here today to give thanks to God for his gifts to us and to thank especially the clergy, religious, and lay parishioners who have made all that has happened here at Holy Parish possible. It is because of their living this spirituality of stewardship that we can have to celebrate today.
Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, that you accept and bless these gifts, these offerings, these holy and unblemished sacrifices, which we offer you firstly for your Holy Catholic Church. Be pleased to grant her peace, to guard, unite, and govern her throughout the whole world, together with your servant Francis, our Pope, and me, your unworthy servant, my brother Ignatius, and all those who, holding to the truth, hand on the Catholic and Apostolic faith. Remember, Lord, your servants, and all gathered here whose faith and devotion are known to you. For them we offer you this sacrifice of praise, for the offering for themselves and all who are dear to them, for the redemption of their souls and hope of health and well-being, and paying their homage to you, the eternal God, living and true. In communion with those whose memory we venerate, especially the glorious ever-Virgin Mary, Mother of our God and Lord Jesus Christ, and blessed Joseph, her spouse, your blessed apostles and martyrs, Peter and Paul, Andrew, and all your saints. We ask that through their merits and prayers, in all things we may be defended by your protecting help. Therefore, Lord, we pray, graciously accept this oblation of our service, that of your whole family. Order our days in your peace, and command that we be delivered from eternal damnation and counted among the flock of those you have chosen. Be pleased, O God, we pray, to bless, acknowledge, and approve this offering in every respect. Make it spiritual and acceptable, that it may become for us the body and blood of your most beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. On the day before he was to suffer, he took bread in his holy and venerable hands, and with eyes raised to heaven, you, O God, his almighty Father, giving you thanks. He said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took this precious chalice in his holy and venerable hands, and once more giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me.
Thank you. Let us pray. Good morning.
Good morning, God.
What a beautiful morning indeed, and truly it is a day of rejoicing. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us be glad and rejoice. We echo the words of our Archbishop to thank God and praise His most holy name for the bountiful blessings we have received for these past 50 years. We salute and give thanks to Reverend Richard Bryan, first pastor here, and of course Monsignor William Flanagan, whose combined efforts from 1954 to 1962 made this church building a reality. Adding color to our wonderful celebration of our 50th anniversary of the dedication of our church is the presence and the pastoral visit of our Archbishop of San Francisco. So I would like to thank our beloved Archbishop Salvatore Cordiglione. Thank you so much for your being. Your presence of being with us today makes this historical and memorable event in our parish truly a meaningful and inspiring experience for all of us. I would also like to thank our brother priests who have come to join the celebrators today. We'll start from our resident bishop, Bishop Ignatius Wallen, former auxiliary bishop of San Francisco. And of course, we have also our former pastor, Father Don D'Angelo, the former the pastor of St. Girl. We're also pastor of St. Veronica, Father Charles Portota, who used to be assigned here at Holy Name. And the product of Holy Name Parish, Father Tedship, now retired. And Father Dan Nascimento, the pastor of St. Brenda. Of course, our associate pastor, Father Tuan Nguyen. Now, I would like to thank special people today, but I would just ask all of you to suspend your applause until the very end or until Moses raises his staff. So I would like to acknowledge the following: the Sisters of Mercy, the Canossian Sisters, and the Sisters of Holy Name. Can you please stand up? Now we have today the presence of the first child baptized in March 22nd, 1964, Catherine Dito and her spouse and siblings. And we would like to to acknowledge also to and ask them to stand those who received the First Communion on March 22, 1964, representing the 144 students of Holy Name School, class 1970, and the CCD students. And those who received their confirmation on April 25th, 1964, representing the 143 students of Holy Name School, class 1965, and CCD students. And those who graduated from Holy Name School on June 8, 1964, representing the 102 Holy Name students, class 1964, who are celebrating with us their 50th class reunion. And we also acknowledge Ludwig Merritt and his wife Emily, the talented sculptor of our crucifix, Blessed Mother, St. Joseph statues, and the Stations of the Cross. And I would like to acknowledge also those who have received the sacraments, those who have attended Holy Name School, and those who have worshipped in this church over the last 50 years. So to all who have participated and who have prepared for this wonderful liturgy, thank you so much, and thank you for your presence and celebrating us today. After the Mass, please join us for our reception at the gym now called Ryan Hall as we continue our celebration with His Excellency Archbishop Salvatore Cordiglione, Archbishop of San Francisco. Again, thank you, and God bless you forever and for always.
The Lord be with you. And may Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.